The following is a free-for-download audiobook available on Google Drive. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 82. Krishna and Balaram meet the inhabitants of Vrindavan. This chapter describes how the Yadavas and many other kings met at Kurukshetra during a solar eclipse and discussed topics concerning Lord Krishna. It also relates how Krishna met Nanda Maharaj and the other residents of Vrindavan at Kurukshetra and gave them great joy. Hearing that a total eclipse of the sun was soon to occur, people from all over Bharatvarsh, including the Yadavas, converged at Kurukshetra to earn special pious credit. After the Yadus had bathed and performed other obligatory rituals, they noticed that kings of Matsya, Ushinara and other places had also come, as well as Nanda Maharaj and the cowherd community of Raja, who were always feeling intense anxiety of separation from Krishna. The Yadavas, overjoyed to see all these old friends, embraced them one by one as they shed tears of happiness. Their wives also embraced one another with great pleasure. When Queen Kunti saw her brother Vasudeva and other members of her family, she put aside her sorrow. Yet still, she said to Vasudeva, quote, "O brother, I am so unfortunate because all of you forgot me during my tribulations. Alas, even one's relatives forget a person whom Providence no longer favors," end quote. Vasudeva replied, quote, "My dear sister, everyone is merely a plaything of fate. We Yadavas were also harassed by Kamsa that we were forced to scatter and take shelter in foreign lands, so there was no way for us to keep in touch with you," end quote. The kings present were struck with wonder upon beholding Lord Sri Krishna and his wives, and they began to glorify the Yadavas for having gotten the Lord's personal association. Seeing Nanda Maharaj, the Yadavas were delighted, and each of them embraced tightly. Vasudeva also embraced Nanda with great joy and remembered how, when Vasudeva was tormented by Kamsa, Nanda had taken his sons, Krishna and Balaram, under his protection. Krishna and Balaram embraced and bowed down to Mother Yashoda, but their throats choked up with emotion, and they could not say anything to her. Nanda and Yashoda lifted their two sons onto their laps and embraced them, and in this way they relieved the distress of separation. Rohini and Devaki also embraced Yashoda, and remembering the great friendship she had shown them, told her that the kindness she had done by raising and supporting Krishna and Balaram could not be repaid even with the wealth of Indra. Then the Supreme Lord approached the young cowherd girls in a secluded place. He consoled them by pointing out that he is all-pervasive, being the source of all energies, and thus he implied that they could never be separated from him. Having at long last reunited with Krishna, the gopis simply prayed to have his lotus feet manifested in their hearts. Text 1. Sukadeva Goswami said, "Once, while Krishna and Balaram were living in Dwarka, there occurred a great eclipse of the sun, just as if the day of Lord Brahma's, the end of Lord Brahma's day had come." Purport. As Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur points out, the words Ata and Ekada are commonly used in Sanskrit literature to introduce a new topic. Here, they especially indicate that the reunion of the Yadus and Vrishnis at Kurukshetra is being narrated out of chronological sequence. Srila Sanatan Goswami explains in his Vaishnava Toshini commentary that the events of this 82nd chapter occur after Lord Balaram's visit to Vraja, chapter 65, and before Maharaj Yudhisthira's Rajasuya sacrifice, chapter 74. This must be so, the Acharya reasons, since during the eclipse at Kurukshetra, all the Kurus, including Dhritarashtra, Yudhisthira, Bhishma, and Drona, met in friendship and happily shared the company of Sri Krishna. At the Rajasuya Jagga, on the other hand, Duryodhana's jealousy against the Pandavas became irrevocably inflamed. Soon after this, Duryodhana challenged Yudhisthira and his brothers to the gambling match, in which he cheated them out of their kingdom and exiled them to the forest. Right after the Pandavas' return from exile, the great battle of Kurukshetra took place, during which Bhishma and Drona were killed. So it is not logically possible for the solar eclipse at Kurukshetra to have happened after the Rajasuya sacrifice. Text 2. Knowing of this eclipse in advance, O King, many people went to the holy place known as Samantapanchak in order to earn pious credit. Purport. Vedic astronomers of 5,000 years ago could predict eclipses of the sun and moon just as well as our modern astronomers can. The knowledge of the ancient astronomers went much further, however, since they understood the karmic influences of such events. Solar and lunar eclipses are generally very inauspicious, with certain rare exceptions, but just as the otherwise inauspicious Ekadasi day becomes beneficial when used for the glorification of Lord Hari, so the time of an eclipse is also advantageous for fasting and worship. The holy place pilgrimage site known as Samantapanchak is located at Kurukshetra, the quote, sacred ground of the Kurus, end quote, where the Kuru king's predecessors performed many Vedic rich sacrifices. The Kurus were thus advised by learned Brahmanas that this would be the best place for them to observe vows during the eclipse. Long before their time, Lord Parashuram had done penance at Kurukshetra to atone for his killings. Samantapanchak, the five ponds he dug there, were still present at the day of Dwapara Yuga, as they are even today. Texts 3 through 6. After ridding the earth of kings, Lord Parashuram, the foremost of warriors, created huge lakes from the king's blood at Samantapanchak. Although he is never tainted by karmic reactions, Lord Parashuram performed sacrifices there to instruct people in general. Thus, he acted like an ordinary person trying to free himself from sins. From all parts of Bart Varsh, a great number of people now come to that Samantapanchak for on pilgrimage. O descendant of Bharat, among those arriving at the holy place were many Vrishnis, such as Gada, Pradyumna, and Samba, hoping to be relieved of their sins. Akura, Vasudev, Ahuka, and other kings also went there. Aniruddha remained in Dwarka with Suchandra, Shuka, and Sharana to guard the city, together with Kritavarma, the commander of their armed forces. Purport. According to Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti, Sri Krishna's grandson, Aniruddha, remained in Dwarka to protect the city because he is originally Lord Vishnu's manifestation as the guardian of the spiritual planet Svetadvip. Texts 7 and 8. The mighty Yadavas passed with great majesty along the road. They were attended by their soldiers who rode on chariots, rivaling the airplanes of heaven, on horses moving with a rhythmic gait, and on bellowing elephants as huge as clouds. Also with them were many infantry as effulgent as celestial Vidyadharas. The Yadavas were so divinely dressed, being adorned with gold necklaces and flower garlands, and wearing fine armor, that as they proceeded along the road with their wives, they seemed to be demigods flying through the sky. Text 9. At Samantapanchak, the saintly Yadavas bathed and then observed a fast with careful attention. Afterwards, they presented Brahmanas with cows, bedecked with garments, flower garlands, and gold necklaces. Text 10. In accordance with scriptural injunctions, the descendants of Vrishni then bathed once more in Lord Parashuram's lakes and fed first-class Brahmanas with sumptuous food. All the while, they prayed, quote, may we be granted devotion to Lord Krishna, end quote. Purport. The second bath marked the end of their fasting on the following day. Text 11. Then, with the permission of Lord Krishna, their sole object of worship, the Vrishnis ate breakfast and sat down at their leisure beneath trees that gave cooling shade. Texts 12 and 13. The Yadavas saw that many of the kings who had arrived there were old friends and relatives. The Matsyas, Ushinaras, Kaushalyas, Vidarbhas, Kurus, Srinjayas, Kambojas, Kakhayas, Madras, Kuntis, and the kings of Anarta and Kerala. They also saw many hundreds of other kings, both allies and adversaries. In addition, my dear King Prickett, they saw their dear friends, Nanda Maharaj and the cowherd men and women who had been suffering in anxiety for so long. Text 14. As the great joy of seeing one another made the lotuses of their hearts and faces bloom with fresh beauty, the men embraced one another enthusiastically. With tears pouring from their eyes, the hairs on their bodies standing on end, and their voices choked up, they all felt intense bliss. Text 15. The women glanced at one another with pure smiles of loving friendship, and when they embraced, their breasts, smeared with saffron paste, pressed against one another as their eyes filled with tears of affection. Text 16. They all then offered obeisances to the elders and received respect in turn from their younger relatives. After inquiring from one another about the comfort of their trip and their well-being, they proceeded to talk about Krishna. Purport. These are the special dealings of Vaishnavas. Even the family entanglements that delude ordinary conditioned souls are no encumbrance for those whose family members are all pure devotees of the Lord. Impersonalists have no capacity for appreciating these intimate dealings, since their philosophy condemns as illusory any kind of personal emotional existence. When followers of impersonalism pretend to understand the loving relationships of Krishna and his devotees, they only create havoc for themselves and whoever listens to them. Text 17. Queen Kunti met with her brothers and sisters and their children, and also with her parents, her brothers, wives, and Lord Mukunda. While talking with them, she forgot her sorrow. Purport. Even the constant anxiety of a pure devotee, apparently just the opposite of the impersonalist Shanti, can be an exalted manifestation of love of God, as exemplified by Srimati Kunti Devi, the aunt of Lord Krishna and the mother of the Pandavas. Text 18. Queen Kunti said, "My dear, respectable brother, I feel that my desires have been frustrated because, although all of you are most saintly, you forgot me during my calamities." Purport. Here, Queen Kunti addresses her brother, Vasudev. Text 19. Friends and family members, even children, brothers, and parents, forget a dear one whom Providence no longer favors. Purport. Srila Sridhar Swami and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur both comment that Kunti does not blame her relatives for her suffering. Thus, she calls them, quote, most saintly persons, end quote, and alludes here to her own bad fortune as the cause of her unhappiness. Text 20. Sri Vasudev said, "My dear sister, please do not be angry with us. We are ordinary, only ordinary men, playthings of fate. Indeed, whether a person acts on his own or is forced by others, he's always under the Supreme Lord's control." Text 21. Harassed by Kamsa, we all fled in various directions, but by the grace of Providence, we have now finally been able to return to our homes, my dear sister. Text 22. Shukadeva Goswami said, "Vasudev, Ugrasena, and the other Yadus honored the various kings who became supremely blissful and content upon seeing Lord Achyuta." Text 23-26. All the royalty present, including Bhishma, Drona, Dhritarashtra, Gandhari, and her sons, the Pandavas and their wives, Kunti, Shanjaya, Vidura, Kripacharya, Kunti Bhoj, Virat, Bhishmaka, the great Nagajit, Purujit, Drupad, Salya, Drishtaketu, Kashiraj, Damagosh, Vishalaksha, Matila, Madra, Kakeya, Yudhamanyu, Shusharma, Balika, and his associates and their sons, and the many other kings subservient to Maharaj Yudhisthira, all of them, O best of kings, were simply amazed to see the transcendental form of Lord Krishna, the abode of all opulence and beauty, standing before them with his consorts. Purport. According to Srila Sridhar Swami, all these kings were now followers of Yudhisthira because he had subjugated each of them to earn the privilege of performing the Rajasuya sacrifice. The Vedic injunctions state that a Kshatriya who wants to execute the Rajasuya for elevation to heaven must first send out a, quote, victory horse, end quote, to roam freely. Any other king whose territory this horse enters must either voluntarily submit or face the Kshatriya or his representatives in battle. Text 27. After Lord Balaram and Lord Krishna had liberally honored them, with great joy and enthusiasm, these kings began to praise the members of the Vrishni clan, Sri Krishna's personal associates. Text 28. The king said, O king of the Bhojas, you alone among men have achieved the truly exalted birth, for you continually behold Lord Krishna, who is rarely visible even to great yogis. Text 29 and 30. His fame, as broadcast by the Vedas, the water that has washed his feet, and the words he speaks in the form of revealed scriptures, these thoroughly purify the universe. Although the earth's good fortune was ravaged by time, the touch of his lotus feet has revitalized her, and thus she is raining down on us the fulfillment of all our desires. The same Lord Vishnu who makes one forget the goals of heaven and liberation has now entered into marital and blood relationships with you, who otherwise travel on the hellish path of family life. Indeed, in these relationships, you see and touch him directly, walk beside him, converse with him, and together with him lie down to rest, sit at ease, and take your meals. Report. All the Vedic mantras glorify Lord Vishnu. This truth is supported with elaborate evidence by learned acharyas like Ramanuja in his Vidartha Sagraha and Madhva in his Rig Veda Bhasya. The words Vishnu himself speaks, such as the Bhagavad Gita, are the confidential essence of all scripture. In his manifestation as Vyasadeva, the Supreme Lord composed both the Vedanta Sutras and Mahabharat, and this Mahabharat includes Sri Krishna's personal statement, Vidis chesavar aham eva vedyo, Vedanta krit vedavit eva chaham, quote, by all Vedas, I am to be known. Indeed, I am the compiler of Vedanta, and I am the knower of the Vedas, end quote. Bhagavad Gita 15:15. When Lord Vishnu appeared before Bali Maharaj to beg three steps of land, the Lord's second step pierced the shells of the universe. The water of the transcendental river Viraja, lying just outside the universal egg, thus seeped inside, washing Lord Vamana's foot and flowing down to become the Ganges River. Because of the sanctity of its origin, the Ganges is generally considered the most holy of rivers. But even more potent is the water of the Yamuna, where Lord Vishnu in his original form of Govinda played with his intimate companions. In these two verses, the assembled kings praise the special merit of Lord Krishna's Yadu clan. Not only do they see Krishna, but they are also directly connected with him by dual bonds of marital and blood relationships. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti suggests that the word bandha, besides its more obvious meaning of, quote, relation, end quote, can also be understood in the sense of, quote, capture, end quote, expressing that the love the Yadus feel for the Lord obliges him to always stay with them. Text 31. Shukadeva Goswami said, when Nanda Maharaj learned that the Yadus had arrived, led by Krishna, he immediately went to see them. The cowherds accompanied him, their various possessions loaded on their wagons. Purport. The cowherds of Raja were planning to stay at Kurukshetra for some days, and so they came equipped with adequate provisions, especially milk products and other foods, for the pleasure of Krishna and Balaram. Text 32. Seeing Nanda, the Vrishnis were delighted and stood up like dead bodies coming back to life. Having felt much distress at not seeing him for so long, they held him in tight embrace. Text 33. Vasudeva embraced Nanda Maharaj with great joy. Beside himself with ecstatic love, Vasudeva remembered the troubles Kamsa had caused him, forcing him to leave his sons in Gokul for their safety. Text 34. O hero of the Kurus, Krishna and Balaram embraced their foster parents and bowed down to them, but their throats were so choked up with tears of love that the two lords could say nothing. Purport. After a long separation, a respectful child should first offer obeisances to his parents. Nanda and Yasoda gave their sons no opportunity for this, however, for as soon as they saw them, they embraced them. Only then could Krishna and Balaram offer their proper respects. Text 35. Raising their two sons onto their laps and holding them in their arms, Nanda and saintly Mother Yasoda forgot their sorrow. Purport. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti explains that after the initial embraces and obeisances, Vasudev led Nanda and Yasoda into a tent as they held the hands of Krishna and Balaram. Following them inside were Rohini, other women and men of Raja, and a number of attendants. Inside, Nanda and Yasoda put the two boys on their laps. Despite having heard the glories of the two lords of Dwarka, and despite seeing these opulences now before their eyes, Nanda and Yasoda looked upon them as if they were still their eight-year-old children. Text 36. Then Rohini and Devaki both embraced the queen of Raja, remembering their faithful friendship she had shown them. Their throats choking with tears, they addressed her as follows. Purport. At this time, according to Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti, Sri Vasudev invited Nanda outside to meet Ugrasena and other elder Yadus. Taking this opportunity, Rohini and Devaki talked with Queen Yashoda. Text 37. Rohini and Devaki said, "What woman could forget the unceasing friendship you and Nanda have shown us, dear Queen of Raja? There is no way to repay you in this world, even with the wealth of Indra." Text 38. Before these two boys had ever seen their real parents, you acted as their parents and gave them all affectionate care, training, nourishment, and protection. They were never afraid, good lady, because you protected them just as eyelids protect the eyes. Indeed, saintly persons like you never discriminate between outsiders and their own kin. Purport. As Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti explains, Krishna and Balaram had not seen their parents for two reasons, because of their exile in Vraja and also because they were never actually born and therefore had no parents. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti also describes that Devaki thought before speaking this verse, quote, "Alas, because for so long these two sons of mine had you, Yashoda, as their guardian and mother, and because they were immersed in such a vast ocean of ecstatic loving dealings with you, now that you are once more before them, they are too distracted to even notice me. Also, you are behaving as if insane and blind with love for them, showing millions of times more maternal affection than I possess. Thus, you simply keep staring at us, your friends, without recognizing us. So let me bring you back to reality on the pretext of some affectionate words." End quote. Then, when Devaki failed to get any response from Yashoda, even after addressing her, Rohini said, quote, "My dear Devaki, it is impossible just now to rouse her out of this ecstatic trance. We are crying in the wilderness, and her two sons are no less bound up in the ropes of affection for her than she is for them. So let us now go outside to meet with Prita, Draupadi, and the others." Text 39. Sukadeva Goswami said, "While gazing at their beloved Krishna, the young gopis used to condemn the creator of their eyelids, which would momentarily block their vision of him. Now, seeing Krishna again, after such a long separation, with their eyes, they took him into their hearts, where they embraced him to their full satisfaction. In this way, they became totally absorbed in ecstatic meditation on him, although those who constantly practice mystic yoga find such absorption difficult to achieve." report. According to Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti, just then Lord Balaram saw the gopis standing a short distance away. Seeing them trembling with eagerness to meet Krishna, and apparently ready to give up their lives if they could not, he tactfully decided to give up and involve himself elsewhere. The gopis then attained the state described in the current verse. In referring to the gopis' intolerant disrespect of Lord Balaram, or Brahma, quote, the creator of eyelids, end quote, Shukadeva Goswami is giving vent to his own jealousy, subtle jealousy of the gopis' favored position. Srila Jiva Goswami offers an alternate understanding of the phrase Nitya Yunam Yujam, which may mean, quote, even of the Lord's principal queens who tend to be proud of their constant association with him, end quote. In Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Srila Prabhupada writes, quote, because they had been separated from Krishna for so many years, the gopis, having come along with Nanda Maharaj and Mother Yashoda, felt intense ecstasy in seeing Krishna. No one can even imagine how anxious the gopis were to see Krishna again. As soon as Krishna became visible to them, they took him inside their hearts through their eyes and embraced them to their full satisfaction. Even though they were embracing Krishna only mentally, they became so ecstatic and overwhelmed with joy that for the time being, they completely forgot themselves. The ecstatic trance which they achieved simply by mentally embracing Krishna is impossible to achieve even for great yogis constantly engaged in meditation on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Krishna could understand that the gopis were rapt in ecstasy by embracing him in their minds, and therefore, since he is present in everyone's heart, he also reciprocated the embracing from within. End quote. Text 40. The Supreme Lord approached the gopis in a secluded place as they stood in their ecstatic trance. After embracing each of them and inquiring about their well-being, he laughed and spoke as follows. Report. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti comments that Krishna expanded himself by his vibhuti shakti to embrace each of the gopis individually, thus waking each of them from her trance. He inquired, are you now relieved of your pain of separation, end quote, and laughed to help lighten their spirits. Text 41. Lord Krishna said, my dear girlfriends, do you still remember me? It was for my relative's sake that I stayed away so long, intent on destroying my enemies. Text 42. Do you perhaps think I'm ungrateful and thus hold me in contempt? After all, it is the Supreme Lord who brings living beings together and then separates them. Purport. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti reveals the gopis' thoughts. Quote, we are not like you who, with your heart shattered by remembering us day and night, give up all sense enjoyment in your distress of separation. Rather, we have not remembered you at all. In fact, we have been quite happy without you. End quote. In response, Krishna asks here whether they resent his ingratitude. Text 43. Just as the wind brings together masses of clouds, blades of grass, wisps of cotton, and particles of dust, only to scatter them all again, so the Creator deals with his created beings in the same way. Text 44. Rendering devotional service to me qualifies any living being for eternal life. But by your good fortune, you have developed a special loving attitude toward me, by which you have attained me. Purport. According to Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti, the gopis then replied, quote, but that Supreme Lord you are blaming is none other than yourself, O most clever of speakers. Everyone in the world knows this. Why should we be ignorant of this fact? End quote. All right, Krishna told them then. If this is true, I must be God, but I am still conquered by your loving affection. End quote. Text 45. Dear ladies, I am the beginning of end and end of all created beings and exist both within and without them, just as the elements ether, water, earth, air, and fire are the beginning and end of all material objects and exist both within and without them. Purport. According to Srila Vishidhar Swami and Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti, Lord Krishna implies the following idea in this verse, quote, "If you know that I am the Supreme Lord, there should be no question of your suffering any separation from me, since I pervade all existence. Your unhappiness must be due to a lack of discrimination. Therefore, please take this instruction from me, which will remove your ignorance." Quote, "But the truth of the matter is that you gopis were, in your previous lives, great masters of yoga, and thus you must already know the science of Gyan Yoga. Furthermore, when I try to teach you this to you in person or through my representative, such as Uddhava, it will not produce the desired result. Gyan Yoga simply causes suffering for those who are fully immersed in pure love of Godhead." End quote. Text 46. In this way, all created things reside within the basic elements of creation, while the spirit souls pervade the creation, remaining in their true identity. You should see both of these, the material creation and the self, as manifest within me, the imperishable supreme truth. Purport. One should properly understand the relationships among the material objects of this world, the elements comprising their basic substance, the individual spirit souls, and the one supreme soul. The various elements of material enjoyment, such as pots, rivers, and mountains, are manufactured from the basic material elements, earth, water, fire, and so on. These elements pervade material things as their cause, while the spirit souls pervade them in their special role as their enjoyer, Svatmana. And ultimately, the material elements, their products, and the living entities are all manifested within and pervaded by the imperishable, perfectly complete Supreme Soul, Krishna. A jnani with realization of these facts should feel no separation from the Lord in any situation, but the gopis of Vraja are much more elevated in their Krishna consciousness than ordinary jnanis, because of their intense love for Krishna in his most human-like, all-attractive aspect. As a young cowherd boy, Krishna's internal potency, Yoga Maya, covered their knowledge of his majestic aspects, such as his all-pervasiveness. Thus, the gopis were able to relish in it the intense ecstasy caused by their love and separation from him. Only in jest is Sri Krishna ascribing to them a lack of spiritual discrimination. Text 47. Shukadeva Goswami said, "Having thus been instructed by Krishna in spiritual matters, the gopis were freed of all tinges of false ego because of their incessant meditation upon him. And with their deepening absorption in him, they came to understand him fully." Purport. Srila Prabhupada renders this passage as follows in Krishna, quote, "The gopis, having been instructed by Krishna in this philosophy of simultaneous oneness and difference, remained always in Krishna consciousness and thus became liberated from all material contamination. The consciousness of the living entity, who falsely presents himself as the enjoyer of the material world, is called jivakosha, which means imprisonment by the false ego. Not only the gopis, but anyone who follows these instructions of Krishna becomes immediately freed from the jivakosha imprisonment. A person in full Krishna consciousness is always liberated from false egoism. He utilizes everything for Krishna's service and is not at any time separated from Krishna." End quote. Text 48. The gopis spoke thus, "Dear Lord, whose navel is just like a lotus flower, your lotus feet are the only shelter for those who have fallen into the deep well of material existence. Your feet are worshipped and meditated upon by great yogis and highly learned philosophers. We wish that these lotus feet may also be awakened within our hearts, although we are only ordinary persons engaged in household affairs." Purport. The translation and word meanings for this verse are taken from Srila Prabhupada's English rendering of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya 181, where this verse is quoted. Revealing the jealous mood in which the gopis spoke these deceptively reverential words, Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti gives their statements as follows, quote, "O Supreme Lord, O directly manifest Supersoul, O crest jewel of the instructors within definitive knowledge, you were aware of our excessive attachment to home, property, and family. Therefore, you previously had Uddhava instruct us in the knowledge that dispels ignorance. And now you have done so yourself. In this way, you have purified our hearts of contamination, and as a result, we understand your pure love for us, free from any motivation other than assuring our liberation. But we are only unintelligent cowherd women. How can this knowledge remain fixed in our hearts? We cannot even meditate steadily on your feet, this focus of realization for great souls like Lord Brahma. Please be merciful to us and somehow make it possible for us to concentrate on you, even a little. We are still suffering the reactions of our own fruitive work, so how can we meditate on you, the goal of great yogis? Such yogis are immeasurably wise, but we are mere feeble-minded women. Please do something to get us out of this deep well of material life. End quote. Pure devotees are never motivated by a desire for material elevation or spiritual liberation, and even if the Lord offers them such benedictions, the devotees often refuse to accept them, as stated by Lord Krishna in the 11th canto Srimad Bhagavatam, 11:20-34. Na kinchit sadavo dira bhaktahi ekantino mama vanchanti api maya datam kaivalyam apurnar bhavam. Quote, because my devotees possess saintly behavior and deep intelligence, they completely dedicate themselves to me and do not desire anything besides me. Indeed, even if I offer them liberation from birth and death, they do not accept it. End quote. It is quite appropriate, therefore, that the gopis respond with a trace of jealous anger to Lord Krishna's attempt at teaching them Jnana Yoga. Thus, according to Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur, the words the gopis speak in this verse may be interpreted as follows. Quote, O sun who directly destroys the darkness of ignorance, we are scorched by the sun rays of this philosophical knowledge. We are chakora birds who can subsist only on the moonlight radiating from your beautiful face. Please come back to Vrindavan with us, and in this way, bring us back to life. End quote. And if he says, quote, then come to Dwarka. There we shall enjoy together. End quote. They reply that Sri Vrindavan is their home, and they are too attached to it for them to take up residence anywhere else. Only there, the gopis imply, can Krishna attract them by wearing peacock feathers in his turban and playing enchanting music with his flute. Only by his appearing again in Vrindavan can the gopis be saved, not by any other kind of meditation on him or theoretical knowledge of the self. Thus end the purports of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 10th canto, 82nd chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled Krishna and Balaram Meet the Inhabitants of Vrindavan.